Jim Capaldi and I met in middle, early 60s perhaps.
I've heard it said, people so.
We met in Birmingham, at the big city.
I was working with Spencer Davis Group. We used to play together, we used to jam together.
We met more, really, from the Elbow Room nightclub in Birmingham, where we used to play. Then Steve was just, from knowing each other, he'd come up and jam. We just started jamming, really, and that's... Jamming is about the whole story of traffic, really. This little old black guy from Louisiana when we heard this record, and then he said, there's this kid from Birmingham. He said, Birmingham? What?
Right from the start, yeah.
I think if you ask anybody in England, from any of the contemporaries, Eric, Elton John, anybody, you know. Yeah, Steve was really a kind of huge influence on everybody in England.
People would come down from Birmingham and say, oh man, there's this kid up there that sings like Ray Charles and he's 15 years old.
Nobody loves you.
I couldn't believe it. I mean, this Sorry Steve, spotty little white kid singing just exactly like Ray Charles.
Steve was definitely, you know, what everybody wanted to be and sound like them. So when we all met and got together and formed the band, we all felt a little pressure because everybody knew Steve.
The idea of putting Traffic together wasn't as much my idea, but it was more of from sitting together and talk. All we really knew is that we jammed together, we could play together.
Yeah.
Traffic came to America, we were three. That was quite an experience, and I think that is in many ways what endeared us to the heart, to the American people. You know, we went straight to the West Coast. We only played about, you know, six or seven songs and played for about two or three hours. And we would go on stage and really not know what we were going to play. We were essentially...
Pretty disorganized.
Yeah. We were doing just perhaps what we would have done at home.
Organized chaos.
I mean, we would like lose equipment and get to the gig and find out that, you know, the gear didn't get there, or there was a lot of that went on.
I think Traffic was a bit of a rare, it's like a slightly rare breed. You know, we weren't as high profile internationally.
Sucked into the ocean. You turn around, come all alone.
sound for the ends of tracks.
It's kind
of
went
of
the on.
Song was always a jam at the end. We used to like ending.
You still do. We pay no attention to the kind of parameters within which a normal pop act should work in. No, if we want to do a 10-minute song, we do it. And if we want, you know, the song to go on 2.5 minutes before there's any vocal, we do it.
Like a brief moment of it being a fantastic party atmosphere, obviously it was a backlash and it got very tense. And like everybody was in your face. Anywhere you went, it was like, yeah, you know, everyone was in your head. You know, it was like, don't give me bad vibes, man. You know, it was vibes and every, you know, so you were living on almost your whole life was out there in a public sense.
The first time was, I think, you know, we were all searching and looking for different things to do. I was. The first time was when I did the Blind Faith project. I don't think it wasn't as fulfilling the playing as Traffic's.
It just seemed like a natural break. You know, when you all feel it's time to take a rest. We were still all around and going to the cottage. And I remember I was there with Ginger Baker was saying, when are you gonna write some lyrics then? And I said, I don't know. It was like, we were all around at the same time. And then it just segued into Traffic again.
40,000 headmen couldn't make me change my mind. If I had to take the choice, between the deaf man and the blind.
I think that I've always kept kept in touch with what made me start to make music. Which was a desire to create something different to what I was hearing.
We didn't make strange sounds to be strange, you know, to make weird stuff.
If you see something that looks like a star.
It was progressive, but it was still rooted in all the influences were there. It was very simple, you know, we didn't try to blind anyone with science.
There's a lot of delicacy and intricacy in music. There needs to be.
And you just can't escape from the sound.
It's important to be able to see that and go onto that level, I suppose, if you like, to be able to put yourself onto that delicate detail level.
It's easy to write kind of arty, weird-sounding things with lots of strings and synth noises going on. but it's very difficult to write a standard form song, but really be a slightly new angle on it.
We didn't want to be an R&B band.
That's what makes it what it is. I think that's what makes Traffic what it was. It was just always slightly different.
I did really take a break during the mid 70s. So I really took a long break from being, you know, an artist, as it were. You are the reason I've been away so long. I felt I was on a bit of a merry-go-round of a tour, an album, and another tour, and I wanted to learn more about recording, engineering, production, about playing with other people, playing different kinds of music.
And then there was a pressure for Steve to say what his next move was going to be, you know. So we all, it was all a bit of a pressure. What was going to happen next?
I worked with a lot of different bands. I worked with an African band called Aye Keita. I worked with a salsa band, the Fanny All Stars. I worked with a Japanese percussionist on the Go Project, Stomi Master. I worked with lots of different, Sandy Denny, Fairport Convention, lots of different things. And I think it was a learning process. I felt I wanted to get away from the strict confines of one band or one group, and I wanted to, I just wanted to broaden my horizons.
It was a very intense period. We look back now sometimes and, you know, it's like we talk about something and we realized it was only 18 months, 2 years, and it seemed like it was 10.
In the mid 80s, I suddenly found that at the age of 40 years old, I had the biggest success that I had in my whole career, which was another kind of surprising little episode. There were times when we didn't really, we got out of touch.
Yeah.
You know, we had the same ideas and likes. And
when you're like old mate, there's always an old, you know, you strike up a bond, don't you, of the experiences that you live through. You know, having survived the 60s together, that makes a strong bond. We've maintained this 30 years of friendship.
We have.
By not really seeing too much of each other. Isn't that what you say?
We'd worked on each other's solo projects.
I had 10 solo albums. You know, Steve helped me on a couple of them, and I worked with various people.
Can we just start that again, sorry?
On my own, as well as writing a song on my own, you know, I always felt limited.
In many ways, solo work can be a strain.
I always felt that I was had an arm missing or a leg missing.
You're all the time being jostled.
40,000 headmen couldn't make me change my mind. If I had to take the choice between the deaf man and the blind, I know just where my feet should go, and that's enough for me. So I turned around and knocked them down, walked across the sea.
There was a real void left by Traffic.
Three small ships are sailing on.
We talked about this over, it had been, you know, fermenting over the last probably four or five years even.
And found a secret cave.
It only happened when it was right. That's like everything always happened with us like that. You know, if we were together, we weren't together, if it felt right. It just seemed to feel right now.
We felt that there was a real need for a band that had that kind of freedom, that kind of looseness, that kind of bacteria that Traffic had. This album, this Far From Home album, this new one that we've just done, well, as far as I'm concerned, it's an album that we made as if we hadn't ever stopped.
You know, we're back in the old firm again.
It wasn't an album where we tried to emulate the sound of the 60s or the 70s or anything like that. It was just an album that it was so easy and so natural.
Times when I don't think I can make it to baby. Don't know what you and me gonna do, baby.
The majority of the material on Far From Home is jammed. We just literally sat down and played.
We just cut it all off our chest.
And yeah, right, all that the last 20 years of playing, of not playing, I should say.
Yeah, but it was good fun. Cook up anything weird. I wouldn't know how to, basically.
Yeah.
There's no point just making weird.
We're not very good at rapping,
sounds,
are we? I've tried. I can't get the rap rhythm somehow.
I don't think we've tried to recreate moments of the past, but we've tried to perhaps engender something of the spirit, possibly, of the past, but I don't think, you know, we certainly haven't tried to make a retro album.
Sometimes your life can be sidetracked. Getting lost in things you don't need. But we all lose direction in a world of greed.
If through my music I can make people perhaps stop and think about on whatever level about their own, where they stand in spiritual terms, you know, with themselves, how they feel, what they think, perhaps give some positive input there. And if I can do that on just the smallest level, then I feel that I've achieved something.
When you're leaving, living in a state grace.
You know, in Traffic, we just sort of all mucked in together, So I never really thought, you know, my lyrics were some sort of on some professional lyricist level. But a great pleasure was to, you know, scribble something down, and then Steve would, you know, pick it up and turn it into something, you know, fantastic.
Living in a state of grace.
There are two things. I mean, Jim is a percussion player, and you know, and I play keyboards and guitar and so. But you see, but I think the main area where we complement each other is in the writing.